Shane Clarum, and this is the presentation on the opioid crisis.
That's good. You did it well.
Thank you. All right, these are your objectives. By the end of the presentation, are you going to know how to define the opioid crisis, list two types of opioids, you'll know how to reverse an opioid overdose, and you'll identify at least three signs and symptoms of opioid use. By the end of the presentation, the learner will suggest one way they can help fight the opioid epidemic. What is the national opioid crisis? It's a serious crisis that affects public health as well as social and economic welfare, and is described as the misuse and addiction of opioids. Basically, there's been an over-reliance on opioids in the last few years, and they've been over-prescribed, which has led to people becoming addicted and abusing them, whether on purpose or just they've accidentally become addicted to them because they're such addictive medications. And there's a couple of them up there. Heroin and fentanyl are two of the worst kinds that we prescribe. Fentanyl in particular is particularly dangerous and extremely addictive. I've got a few statistics here. There's more than 115 people die every single day due to the opioid crisis. And at least 21 to 29% of patients are prescribed opioids for their chronic pain. Or 29 to 29% of them abuse it that are prescribed it. And 80% of heroin users, they started out on opioids and then they progressed to the harder drugs. A lot of times it's when the prescriptions are, they run out or they're not renewed and then they have to get their fix somewhere else. A baby is born addicted to opioids every 19 minutes. Basically what happens is a mother may be taking Norcos or Percocet, say for back pain, chronic back pain, gets pregnant, and then that stays in the system, and when the baby's born, they're addicted to those opioids. Medicaid covers nearly 4 in 10 non-elderly people with opioid addiction. Non-elderly people. A lot of times the older generation, they take opioids just for chronic pain, but it's become more and more problematic in the last couple of years. The younger people are becoming addicted too, hence the 4 in 10 non-elderly. And there's a huge cost to the opioid crisis. Like this says that more than $1 trillion since 2001 has been used to treat and or help fix this crisis. Well, it's not really fixing it, it's gone towards this crisis, and it may exceed another $500 billion in the next 3 years. And the costs come from treatments, which are expensive. When, say, a patient overdoses, they come into the emergency room. You've got to give drugs like Narcan to reverse it, and then the hospital bills pile up, and they may not have the means to pay for it. When they're missing work, it's costing the economy. Things like accidents, if they're on the drug and they have an accident, that can cause issues. They can cause an accident, and the insurance company has to pay for it too, which is another cost. Which is what I go into here. Healthcare costs related to the crisis exceeded $215 billion since 2001. And just like I said a second ago, emergency room visits are a huge part of that cost. You go to the emergency room for anything, it's expensive, but if you come in for an overdose, they've got to reverse the drug, sometimes they have to try and make you throw up, then they've got to do CTs and things like that, and all of that costs a small fortune. And again, touched on the previous slide, it costs employers a lot of money too. $2.6 billion in 2016. That's almost a tenfold increase from about 10 years ago. Basically, any time you miss work, it's costing the employer money. If you go in high, damage property, it's costing your employer money. I wanted to go into some signs and symptoms of opioid abuse. varies greatly. It's quite hard to tell if someone is on taking opioids, and plus they build up a tolerance to them. And when they're on the drug, a lot of times they'll be happy, euphoric because of that initial burst of the drug, which is what causes problems later on because that wears down as their tolerance goes up, so they need more of the drug. And if they don't get the drug, they move on to harder drugs. Some other ones, it can cause confusion, slow breathing, constipation is a big one. People become withdrawn socially and have financial problems as they want to keep up with their addiction. And then sort of emotional problems such as anxiety, because if they don't get the drug, they need that fix, they start panicking, they don't get that fix, they become anxious, become depressed, suicidal, their moods change constantly. The U.S. Department of Human Health and Human Services is focused on five priorities: improving access to treatment and/or recovery, promoting use of overdose-reversing drugs like Narcan, reinforcing our understanding of the crisis through better health, public health services, surveillance, financing for cutting-edge research on pain addiction, and advancing more effective practices for pain management. Basically, the biggest one would be this, is that they're trying to move away from opioids now and help manage people's pains in different ways with different medications such as NSAIDs or through just trying to distract people from their pain, doing other holistic treatments such as like yoga, basically all just to get away from this over-reliance on opioids. According to a 2015 survey that the Department of Health of Mississippi did, an average of 107 opioid prescriptions per 100 people, which is 30 higher than the national rate. There were 180 related deaths in Mississippi, opioid-related deaths in Mississippi. And between 2013 and 16, the toll was on the rise. Deaths from heroin increased 10 to 33. Deaths from synthetic opioid overdose increased from 24 to 45, which is things like fentanyl. And deaths from prescription opioid overdose increased 63 to 103. That doesn't mean that people were suicidal or that they were even the people taking the drugs were necessarily the ones who were hurt. It can be people who are inadvertently killed by it. If you don't dispose of the fentanyl patches correctly, the child can reach into a trash can, which has happened here, and they chewed on it, and that child died from chewing on a discarded fentanyl patch because it wasn't disposed of properly, which is why we always have two nurses cut it up and flush it. How can we make a difference as healthcare professionals? It's basically going over a lot of things we talk about. Help patients understand the treatments, which we do every day, and the consequences to it. Use health recorded integrated prescription drugs as an important tool in preventing inappropriate access to prescription drugs. Basically just keeping track of those prescriptions and seeing if they're being filled, when they're being filled, and making sure that people aren't going out and just trying to refill those drugs unnecessarily or continuously. And educate people on non-medication treatment options, which we went over, things like yoga, just as a way of managing the pain or through exercise and getting that euphoric state from that. And then and providing them a treatment with respect and dignity, no matter what. A lot of times people just want to, or they think that you're, if you ask that they ask for pain medication, they think that they're being perceived as a drug user. And they're not. medications, Tylenol and NSAIDs, and corticosteroids. These are treatments for that can be used instead of opioids. You can use RISE for fractures, which is rest, light, suppression, and elevation. Neurostimulators, exercise or physical therapy, which we touched on, acupuncture, massages, or hypnotherapy, or meditation. And these are being started to be promoted more and more instead of opioids and like our internal medicine. We're not allowed to. We used to have a list of drugs we could add, and Norco was one of those that was on there, but it's since been removed. And Tylenol is about as painful a drug as we can add ourselves as nurses. What is needed to prevent more death? Safe, effective, non-addictive strategies to manage chronic pain, such as we talked about before, such as NSAIDs, such as physical therapy, such as diet imagery, things like that. New innovative medications, technologies to treat opioid use disorders. Just things like counseling and I'll be done in a minute. Other things. And improved opioid prevention and reverse interventions to save lives and support recovery, such as giving Narcan and things like that in the emergency room. Without these, the toll will continue to rise. But the biggest prevention method would be not to, or to cut down the prescription of opioids in the first place. And in conclusion, as with all public health initiatives, widespread education is important. It can take many years for it to take effect. Previous campaigns against smoking and drug driving have been a success, but as we know, it can take time and hard work to make significant progress. Opioid addiction is going to take a tremendous level of effort and collaboration, and nurses will be among those at the forefront in the battle of this epidemic. The biggest way we can help is through our education. We discharge patients home, tell them what they can do for pain other than taking opioids, and when they're here, that we can provide them with other alternatives than just going to get them opioids and trying to make them feel better that way. We can do heating pads, help them get up and move around if they're their back pain is just because they've been laying in bed all day, or maybe you can consult with physical therapy or someone to, or occupational therapy to help the patients that way, again, instead of prescribing them with opioids. And that's it. Thank you.